Welcome to worship as we gather together here virtually for the 20th Sunday after Trinity Sunday. Once again, as I have been trying to do these last few weeks, let's have just a little focal point to kind of keep in the back of our minds what this point of the service is all about. Our goal is everlasting life with God. And because of that, it's only natural that we wonder, what is God like? Well, we can't answer that question in terms of life in this world, but today's liturgy focuses us and our attention on the characteristics of God that make us realize what a wonderful God he is. We are assured that great blessings come to those who trust God and accept his truth. And this truth referred to by Jesus is the gospel that sets us free from sin to be sons and daughters of this most wonderful God. God is truly the King who invites us to his feast, celebrating the marriage feast of his son to the church. And the wedding garment that he gives us in the gospel is his righteousness given us by faith. We're going to be singing hymn number 430 as our opening hymn, but we're just going to sing the first three stanzas, and then at the end of the service, we're going to close out with the final three stanzas. So, we begin with our hymn of invocation, 430, My Song is Love Unknown, stanzas 1 through 3.
Thank you.
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins to God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Brothers and sisters in various places across the internet, and I'm so thankful to God that we've reached far and wide. Our little country church here is being received by people in three different countries and two different continents. And that's very heartening at times to know that no matter where you are, we are all children of God. And as such, if this is your penitent confession, then I have good news reserved just for you. Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our psalm for today is Psalm 27, verses 1 to 9. Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I have asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. O you who have been my help, cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Old Testament reading for today is from the prophet Isaiah, the 55th chapter. Titled The Compassion of the Lord. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me, hear that your soul may live, and I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation that you do not know, and a nation that did not know you shall run to you, because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel. For he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our gradual for today is Psalm 145, verses 15 and 16. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand. You satisfy the desire of every living thing. Our epistle for today is from Ephesians, the 5th chapter, where Paul says, Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with all your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 22nd chapter. Again, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son, and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who were invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find.' And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" This is the gospel of the Lord. We continue now with our hymn of the day, which is number 528, "We Are Called to Stand Together." Number 528.
Thank you.
Our sermon for today is titled, A Lesson in History, and it's based on all the readings for today. The grace, mercy, and peace of Christ Jesus rest upon each and every one of you this day. Finish the sentence for me, if you can. Those who don't learn from history are doomed to repeat it, right? Or how about this one? There's nothing new under the sun. History is good. History is, in fact, great. History is a great teacher, if you're willing to learn from it. We're not going through anything right now that our forefathers haven't gone through before us. That includes this pandemic. It happened in the 50s, it happened in the 19-teens, it happened in the 1870s and in the 1840s. It's happened many, many times. You mean to tell me that we're not the only ones to ever have to experience war on terror, economic uncertainty, global pandemic? No. Are we the only ones to ever have poor excuses for government leadership? No. Are we the only ones to ever have to experience the persecution of faith? Come on, please. Of course not. So history is a great teacher. And we can stand to learn a lot from our forefathers. When Martin Luther preached on this very same gospel text that we just heard, the text that tells of a very angry king who utterly destroys and lays waste to all those who arrogantly reject his gracious invitation to his wedding feast, well, Luther mentioned how this was already glimpsed in the history of God's people. For example, Luther pointed to the Old Testament Jewish people, God's chosen Israel, who had repeatedly thumbed their noses at him and chose to do their own thing. And we have tons of biblical examples of this. This isn't just a one-time occurrence by any stretch. In 722 BC, the wicked Assyrians sacked Israel, laid waste to them, and hauled them off into oblivion and bondage. And you'd think that this would scare straight the Israelite relatives to the south, but it didn't. By 586 BC, those impenitent and thick-necked fools are also hauled off into bondage, taken to Babylon. But God didn't let them remain in death and bondage. God was faithful. He had made a promise that his Messiah would come from the line of Israel. Yes, he would come from the burnt-out stump of the family tree of Jesse, but he would still come. And God is faithful to his word and his promise. So in 536 BC, God uses a Persian, in other words, an Iranian, by the name of Cyrus, to free his people and get them back to the land that he'd promised them. And they return, and upon their return, surprise, surprise, they go right back to their old ways. But faithful and patient God doesn't quit on them. He sends a faithful outsider, a faithful Jew who worked in the administration of Cyrus by the name of Nehemiah, back to lead the temple rebuild and the reestablishment of Israel as a nation. And the temple finally does get rebuilt. But of course, the joy doesn't last. God's people go right back to doing what they had always done. And by the time Jesus is on the scene, they go right back to doing what they had always done. Israel has gone right back to the vomit of their own self-righteous and greed and arrogant pride. We are children of Abraham, they tell Jesus. We've never been enslaved to anyone. Who do you think you are, Jesus? Really? Your Lord himself made it very clear that such rebelliousness and unfaithful works righteousness and unwillingness to repent and humble themselves would result in that same temple, this temple that they were so proud of, the monumental pride of Jerusalem, being laid waste, not one stone left upon another. And in 70 AD, your Lord's word and promise came to fruition. God used pagan Rome to sack and destroy that which had become an idol to the false gods of works righteousness. And all of these examples are really just looking at one little snapshot in the history of God's people. Ever since the day man took it upon himself to be God's equal, we children of Adam have been on a monotonous treadmill of sin and death, always thinking that things are somehow different with us, even though there is nothing new under the sun. Now, I know that we don't like to think of God as this angry God who destroys and lays waste the impenitent and arrogant unbelief. Well, let me rephrase that. We don't like to think that we're the ones who are the bad guys in that parable. We're not the ones who are getting destroyed. We hear this parable and we immediately like to cast ourselves as those lowly, undeserving ones who were out at the crossroads of life and who've been brought into the feast. We are the good guys, and if destruction is going on in our lives, if there's a little bit of weeping and gnashing of teeth, well, it's only because we're collateral damage. We're innocent victims caught up in the swell as God reproves and rebukes those sinners. My friends, examine yourself. Examine your own history. An honest look from God's perspective will tell you that you are not a poor, innocent victim. You are guilty. You are the perpetrator. I am too, just like our forefathers before us. But dear brothers and sisters of the King, I don't want you to fret or despair over your salvation. I can't stress this enough. By God's grace and working, you have been clothed in Christ's robe of righteousness. Yes, we are sinners who do often reject and despise his gracious invitations. There are plenty of times that we would never be accused of being a faithful, humble child of God. But, as God tells us again and again and again, he disciplines those whom he loves. The loving Father chastises and disciplines his children, not because he hates them, but because he loves them. Now, does that mean that God doesn't get angry? Who here hasn't been angry at someone you love? Most of you are parents. What happens when your child messes up? Do you get angry? Yes, but that doesn't mean you don't stop loving them. You might even tell them, you know, I've taught you better than this. You're above this. So don't be deceived. Your sins do make God angry. God doesn't get just a little sad or a little depressed when you sin. No. He's a loving Father who does get rightly and righteously angry. And I know that may not fit the kindler, gentler, lifetime channel version of God that we would prefer to believe in, but this is the God of Scripture. This is the God of history. This is the same God who made a whip of cords and raised his righteous voice as he disciplined his rebellious and wayward children. This is the God and Father of all mankind, who doesn't want to see us go down the paths that so many have gone before. We, of all people, clothed in his righteousness and grace, we should know better. We have a whole history of his word to tell us and teach us and show us. So, yes, we are living in very tough and scary times right now. We are witnessing God's loving, righteous, disciplinary anger against sin and rebellion and apathy and self-serving greed and pride. What you see on TV and hear from those around you may give you the impression that God is very angry with us and is punishing us and is out to destroy us. But he disciplines and chastises and calls to repentance. But he doesn't punish sin on this side of eternity. All of the punishment for all sin has already been poured out upon his only begotten Son in that one moment of time. That one single moment when Christ could and did rightly call out, my God, why have you forsaken me? All of God's anger against sin has already been put on Christ and put to death on the cross once and for all. So, my dear children, rejoice. Give thanks unto the Lord, for we are those who feast with the King this very day, and it's only going to get better. This is the foretaste of the feast to come. Yes, we are still rebellious children of Adam, but we're also simultaneously redeemed children of God. But don't forget, all of this is by his grace. It's his free and unmerited gift to you and to me, and that includes the humble and repentant garment of faith that knows and acknowledges the truth that we are unworthy sinners who deserve nothing but present and eternal punishment. So may you learn from history. May you never forget this blessed history, this divine, present, which is Christ's all-availing and all-covering righteousness given to you in his word and his sacraments, and your blessed and joyous future, that never-ending heavenly feast with your bridegroom and king. May you be clothed and covered over in this righteousness and this peace now and into all eternity. Amen. We now continue by confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. As each petition ends with, Lord, in your mercy, you are invited to respond in your own home, wherever you are. Hear our prayer. Almighty God, we give thanks for all your goodness and bless you for the love that sustains us from day to day. We praise you for the gift of your Son, our Savior, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, for your Holy Church, for the means of grace, for the lives of all faithful and just people, and for the hope of the life to come. Help us to treasure in our hearts all that you have done for us, and enable us to show your thankfulness in lives that are wholly given to your service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sanctify our homes with your presence and bless them with joy. Keep our children in the covenant of their baptism and enable their parents to bring them up in lives of faith and devotion. Unite the members of all families in a spirit of affection and service that they may show your praise in our land and in all the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. By your word and Holy Spirit, comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Be with those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those to whom death draws near. Bring consolation to those in sorrow, and grant to all a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you in your church on earth, who now rest from their labors. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints, and bring us at last to the joys of your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Amen. Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. As I mentioned at the beginning of the service, we're now going to continue by singing the final four stanzas of hymn number 430, My Song is Love Unknown, 430. For coming and being a part of worship with us today. I hope that you find this history lesson helpful in knowing that all through history, God has continually chastised his people, not to punish them, but to call them back to repentance and faith. And so, as you go through your week, pray that the world will come to repentance and that God may restore us from our current punishment. Amen. Thank you.